You know, the first derivative of a function from C to C is a complex number. The second derivative is also a complex number. Okay? Whereas if you think of the function from R2 to R2, namely z equal to x plus iy, so you have a function from x plus iy, that is x comma y, to real part of f, imaginary part of f. This is a function from R2 to R2. And the question is, why is that real business, when you think of it as a real business versus thinking of it as a complex business? The answers seem to be different. Now, did anyone think about this? Is it clear what I'm asking? Is it clear what I'm asking, that complex differentiability of a function from C to C and real differentiability of the function f from R2 to R2, okay? Why do the answers seem to be so different? And one of you had answered. Who? Himanshu, I think you had answered. It has to do with what?
The linear maps, R linear maps and the C linear maps.
So it's R linear maps and C linear maps. Now, could you understand what the connection is? Okay, so you have a R linear map and you have a C linear map. So a R linear map from R2 to R2 that extends to a C linear map from C to C. Okay, what is the relationship between these two? That is the kind of question. And you will understand that this has something to do with what? If you take the matrix A minus B, BA, and multiply it by the matrix D minus C, CA, 2x2 matrices. Actually, I have not written this down. Maybe I'll write it down the next time. I don't know if I've written it down this time. So look at the following 2x2 matrices. Which 2x2 matrices? The first one is, have a pen and paper and write this down as I'm saying. It's A minus B, that's the first row. And the second row is B, A. And multiply it by the 2x2 matrix D minus C, first row, C, D. And then you will see that you get something about the complex numbers. So A minus B, B, A can be identified with A plus IB. D minus C, C, A can be identified with D plus IC. And you're multiplying these two complex numbers. So please think about it. It's worth worrying about. And we'll see how it goes. Okay, there was one thing yesterday that... where do I want to go? I want to minimize this. Where I had made a mistake in that last problem. So let me just start by correcting that mistake I had made. Just minimize. Which is that... you know, the exercise was f from R2 to R3, and I'd made some screw up about the example. So, I mean, I'm just modifying, changing that example a little bit. So you actually get a function from R2 to R3, which is something. And then you're supposed to calculate the second derivative of f at x. So you calculate the first derivative of f at x, which everyone can do, and then calculate the second derivative of f, evaluated at 1, 2, evaluated at 3, 4, evaluated at 5, 6. And more generally for x, y, z in R2, calculate the second derivative of f at x, evaluated at y, evaluated at z. Now, you will understand that there's some care that you have to take to even calculate the second derivative of the function, okay? And obviously to calculate higher order derivatives, okay, you have to take much more care. And you will see that there is some pattern that is emerging in all these things. D2f at x, y, z is what? So on and so forth. And one more comment I should make here is that one of you had sent me a question, what should one say, doubt. Roshini, I think her name is. Had sent me a doubt about what, you know, the first derivative is tangent, first derivative from R2 to R2 is the best linear approximation, and what can you say about the higher order derivatives? Okay, and that is actually a interesting question, because it turns out the higher order derivatives correspond to the higher order derivatives are what turns up in what is called the Taylor's formula in multi dimensions. And each of the summands in the Taylor's formula is actually the best, the kth summand is the best K multilinear map approximation to F restricted to the diagonal. Now, what exactly this means is something that you need a little bit of time to understand. But it turns out that this idea also, all these ideas are quite important, approximating a function by multilinear maps. And you know, if you have any friends who are doing physics, lots of physics people do precisely this, finding best multilinear approximations to whatever function they're looking at, find structure constant and whatever, they have fancy ways of talking about it. And to get better and better approximations, you have to get higher and higher order approximations. And for that, you need multilinear expansion. So this idea of taking a function and expanding it out into multilinear summands, again, is an idea that occurs in many branches. Okay, so that was for the real thing. And then now I had told you that we must start thinking in terms of geometry. Okay, and this is what most people find very difficult to digest. And this is understandable because, I mean, you always find the algebra to be the easiest, so to say. Then you find analysis to be the next easiest and geometry to be the most difficult in some sense. And that really is a wrong way of looking at things. You always have an inbuilt geometric intuition which most people do not use. And you must try to understand things using your geometric interpretation of various things. So what do I mean by that? So much for a general statement. So you take F from C to C, Fz is equal to Z squared. That means omega, you know, this is the standard notation that Z is supposed to be the variable in the domain and W is supposed to be the variable in the codomain. So Z is in the domain C and W is in the image FW, Fz equal to W, also in C. So this is standard usual notation that W is equal to F of Z. Okay, F of Z is Z squared. That means that F of Z is Z, F plus IY, which is that, X squared minus Y squared plus 2XY, which is equal to W has the coordinates. See, Z has real and imaginary parts X and Y, and W has a real and imaginary parts mu plus I nu. And therefore, you get the real part of W is X squared minus Y squared, and the imaginary part of W is 2XY. And therefore, these things tell you something, okay? What is this, okay? If you look at mu equal to constant, the straight lines in the W plane, mu equal to a constant and nu equal to a constant. These are what mu equal to a constant is the vertical straight line in the W plane. Nu equal to constant is the horizontal straight line in the W plane. So these two vertical and horizontal straight lines in the W plane, where do they come from? So first of all, these horizontal and vertical straight lines in the W plane are orthogonal. They are the translates of the X and the Y axis in the W plane. I should say mu and the nu axis in the W plane. And where do they come from? They will come from X squared minus Y squared equal to C and 2XY equal to D. But what are these sets in the Z plane? C and D are constants. What are these sets in the Z plane? X squared minus Y squared equal to C, 2XY equal to D. And you know that these sets are, okay, these are what? I shouldn't say, why am I writing parabolas? These are hyperbolas. Why have I written that? X squared minus Y squared is equal to C and 2XY equal to D are hyperbolas. Why I have written parabolas. Anyway, so please cancel that parabolas out, and you have these curves in the xy plane. And what you notice is that these two curves, x squared minus y squared equal to c to xy equal to d, are orthogonal. That means where they intersect orthogonally. And what is the meaning of intersect orthogonally? It means that the tangents to these two curves at that point of intersection are perpendicular. Okay? So these two orthogonal curves, these are hyperbolas. These two orthogonal hyperbolas are mapped to orthogonal straight lines. Similarly, the other way around, x equal to c and the straight line x equal to c is mapped to mu equal to c squared minus x squared, nu equal to 2cy, and therefore when you eliminate y, you get some relationship between nu squared and mu squared. And this, okay, why am I calling this a parabola? This should be an hyperbola. So these two things are orthogonal, and similarly, this is a parabola. Okay, y equal to d is a parabola, whereas that is a hyperbola. Anyway, so parabolas and hyperbolas, and these images are orthogonal. I'm not going to go through these calculations. Okay, just I hope you will do that. Okay, and if r is fixed and you have this circle, okay, then this circle is mapped to this circle, 2 to the 1 manner, and sectors, these lines, straight lines through the origin, are mapped to straight lines through the origin, and straight lines through the origin are orthogonal to circles around the origin, and their images also are orthogonal to each other, okay? Note that C1 and L1 are orthogonal, and C2 and FC, C2 equal to FC1, L2 equal to FL1 are orthogonal. Okay. And sectors, what do I mean by sector? S1 is all those R's, all R is positive. The angle lies between two fixed numbers, alpha and beta. So I should call it the sector S alpha beta. The sector S alpha beta is mapped to the sector. I should not call it sector. What should I call it? I should call it the wedge. The wedge S alpha beta is mapped to the wedge S2 alpha 2 beta. Okay. So wedges. I hope you know what I'm saying. Wedge. W-E-D-G-E. Okay. The wedge of a pizza. That wedge. A pizza slice is a wedge. W-E-D-G-E. So wedges are mapped to wedges with the angle at the vertex doubled. Okay. There is also a rotation involved. Okay. So I'm describing these things. What is the exercise? Exercise is draw all these things that I'm talking about here. Okay. These parabolas, hyperbolas, wedges, circles, straight lines. Okay. Draw all these straight lines and try to prove that they intersect orthogonally. Okay. And therefore, you want to ask this question, that given open sets omega 1 and omega 2 contingency, does there exist a holomorphic function f which maps omega 1 to omega 2? So you should, this is one of the most important questions that one can ask. Given two domains, omega 1 and omega 2, can you find a holomorphic function which maps one domain to the other? Okay. And I'm sort of doing something like this with these examples that you have here. And the question you should ask is, what happens for the other, your favorite other holomorphic maps? That means you take exponential of z is one of your favorite holomorphic maps. You take cos z, sin z is another of your favorite exponential maps. And you take these powers, w equal to z to the n. Okay. What gets mapped to what? Okay. So I hope you will do this exercise. Okay. I mean, you have probably been using all these maps for a long time and you know that they're holomorphic. The question is what gets mapped to what? I mean, if omega is something subset of C, exponential of omega should be what? Or you choose omega to be nice and you tell me what exponential of that omega, what is the image under the exponential map of that omega? And verify this business about orthogonality, which we will do very soon, okay? Can someone tell me what happens for XZ? Where am I now? I should go here. Then I should go here. And the question is, what happens for XZ? What can you say about XZ? What gets mapped to what? No.
Line parallel to y-axis. Huh? Map to circle.
Line parallel to the y-axis. Okay, that means it's e to the I theta. So these get mapped to circles of radius, that intersection, correct? What else?
Yes.
What about horizontal lines? Parallel horizontal lines parallel to the x-axis get mapped to?
Kind of annulus.
So they get mapped to annulus. That's correct. Okay. So you have to check all these things. What else can one say? What about the function cos z? Has anyone thought about this question for cos z? What gets mapped to what? I would be very pleasantly surprised if someone has thought about this. Yeah. Himanshu. Cos z, what happens?
Cos z, we can think like the real part of exponential of, so.
So cos z is e to the I z plus e to the minus I z divided by 2 or whatever it is, that formula. Okay. So what happens in this case? What can you say? You know, the whole point here is that these are natural questions to be asked, okay? And these questions, someone in the previous lecture, someone was asking what is canonical and what is natural, okay? So I'm glad Nitin said something about it. So the question here is, these are quote unquote natural questions to be asked when you're reading a book, okay? And this is part of what I meant by saying that reading a book is not a passive process, but reading a book is a very active process, because at every stage you should be asking these kind of questions. Now, all of you have seen everything that I have said so far before, but you probably would not have thought about it or thought about these questions in this manner. So finding what gets mapped to what, developing this geometric intuition for holomorphic functions, x, z, cos z, sine z, z to the n, z squared, okay, actually helps a great deal. So, and you must learn to ask these kind of questions, okay, when you're reading something. I mean, all these answers to all the questions are there in the books. You have to learn how to read it correctly. So reading is, how to read a book is also something that people have to consciously learn, if you know what I'm saying. So anyway, these are natural questions and you must ask questions like this at all times. Now, what do I have to do to get there? I don't have to do this, I have to do this probably. Okay, so for each of these examples, what can you say? So this orthogonality is a particular case of what we call angle preserving properties of holomorphic functions. And this again, all of you have seen at some point of time. You take two curves in C, and the curves you're going to talk about are nice curves. So they're differentiable curves in C. Okay, so you have gamma 1 and gamma 2, and they pass through the point A0. And suppose I pass through the point A naught at zero. This is zero and minus one, one, etc. I mean, all of you know that it does not matter. And suppose the derivatives are non-zero, okay, of this curve. See, gamma is a curve from minus one, one to C. And therefore, you can talk about the derivative of gamma. It's a tangent to the curve. And I want to say that the tangent is not zero. Okay, so there actually exists a tangent. And what do you mean by the angle between these curves at that point of intersection? So the angle between the curves at the point of intersection is the angle between the tangent to the curve, tangents to the curve, okay, at that point of intersection. So gamma 1, 0, gamma 1 prime of 0 is the tangent, okay. Gamma 2 prime at 0 is the tangent to gamma 2. And we are not interested in the size, absolute value. We are interested only in the angle. Okay. And what is the angle? The angle between gamma 1 and gamma 2. So if you put gamma 1 prime is equal to some, you write it in polar form. Gamma 2 prime, you write it in polar form. Theta 1 is the argument of gamma 1 prime. Theta 2 is the argument of gamma 2 prime at 0. And we define the angle between gamma 1 and gamma 2. These are the curves which intersect at gamma 1 of 0 equal to gamma 2 of 0. And we define the angle to be equal to theta 2 minus theta 1. Okay. And remember, the order is also there. The angle between gamma 1 and gamma 2 is theta 2 minus theta 1, which is argument of gamma 2 prime 0 minus argument of gamma 1 prime 0. I have not said what the argument is. I hope all of you know that. Okay. So if f is a holomorphic function whose derivative at a naught is not equal to 0, sigma 1 and sigma 2, okay, sigma 1 and sigma 2 are curves in C, which are the images of the curves gamma 1 and gamma 2, okay, by f. So gamma is a curve f in C. So f composed with gamma will be another curve in C, which are called sigma 1. F composed with gamma 1 is another curve, which I call sigma 1. F composed with gamma 2 is another curve, which I call sigma 2. Both of them intersect at sigma 1, 0, which is equal to sigma 2 of 0, which is F composed with gamma 1 at 0, which is F composed with gamma 2 at 0. Okay? F maps the curves gamma 1 and gamma 2 in the z-plane to the curves sigma 1 equal to F composed with gamma 1, sigma 2, etc. The angle between these two is argument of sigma 1 of 0 minus argument sigma 2 of 0, which is argument of f prime a 0. This is the chain rule. I should ask you to write down what is the chain rule in whatever. Anyway, it goes too far away. So argument of f prime a 0 minus argument of gamma 2 prime 0. So it's only arguments. The absolute values are not involved. And therefore, that is argument of this minus argument of that. And what this is saying is that the angle between the curves is preserved for holomorphic functions, okay, at points where f prime a 0 is not equal to 0, okay. That means holomorphic functions have the angle preserving property, okay. So every holomorphic function preserves angles at points where the derivative is non-zero. Okay. Again, you should ask yourself the question, what happens if f prime of a 0 is 0? Have I written that? I don't think I've written that. I should have written that. So I should write here, what happens if f prime at a 0 is equal to 0? So a function is for which, you know, I don't want to say that the derivative exists, but it's enough to say that this absolute value exists for all a, and which has the angle. So I'm saying holomorphic functions have the angle preserving property. Now I'm going to say that a function having the angle, you see, having the angle preserving property, okay, I don't have to say that it is holomorphic. So if it is angle preserving and this limit exists, I will say that the function is a conformal map. And therefore, what we have is that holomorphic functions are conformal. Okay. So this is actually an important criteria. It's very useful that this property about holomorphic functions, again, it's a geometric property about holomorphic functions. And this property is a very useful property. Holomorphic functions are conformal. And then the question you want to ask is, what happens for f from R2 to R2? These are real valued functions of a real variable. I mean, of a variable on R2, Rn. What happens for a function f from Rn to Rn? What can you say about angle preserving? How would you try to formulate angle preserving for functions from R2 to R2? Whatever that means, okay? So this is one aspect of geometry. What happens to curves? What happens to graphs? What happens to regions? And you will understand that mapping one region to the other, domain to the other, is an important question. And this is a question that arises in many areas of mathematics. In particular, it arises when you're talking about fluid mechanics, hydromechanics, or fluid flow, or flow of rivers, or ocean flow, and things like that. Because you want to find out how does the fluid flow along a certain region. Whereas you know how the fluid flows when all the sides are straight, parallel. So anyway, that comes, I'm sure some of you at least will be working, will probably be working on fluid dynamics. Does anyone here do fluid dynamics? Anyone in this audience does fluid dynamics for his PhD? No? Anyway, you might have friends who are doing fluid dynamics, and these people who do fluid dynamics are very worried about these kind of holomorphic functions which take a region to another region. Because in the first region, you know what the solution to Navier-Stokes is. You want to find out solutions to Navier-Stokes in the other equation region, and you use this map, holomorphic map, which allows you to do that, lets you do that. Okay, so I'm not saying too much about that. Okay. So what are the simplest or the most important maps that you have that are holomorphic? Now, again, you know, this is again an idea that one should always have at the back of your mind. You're talking about analytic maps. What are the most important maps, or what are the simplest maps that are holomorphic? Okay, and if you think about it, the simplest maps are translation, and let's keep this inversion, Z going to 1 by Z, and Z going to BZ, where B is a complex number. Okay, so S1 is translation by A, I should call it S sub A, S2 is inversion, and S3 is, you know, I should call it dilation and rotation, because my number B is a complex number. Okay, if it was just a real number, I would call it a dilation. If it was, B was a complex number of absolute value 1, then I would call S3 a rotation. Okay. And so instead of calling it a dilation, or I just call it dilation, including dilations and rotations. So rotations are also there in S3. So in some sense, these are the simplest kind of holomorphic functions that you have. Let's not worry about this. 1 by Z is not holomorphic at Z equal to 0. We'll be going around this very soon. And that is why you had this business of the extended complex plane, C union infinity. And C union infinity is also, adding that point at infinity is something that is again a very common idea in lots of mathematics. Okay, so these are so this, again, I should emphasize, this is we are talking about holomorphic functions. What are the examples that you have? So the simplest examples are translations, dilations, and inversions. Okay. And as I said, I'm not here terribly worried about the fact that S2Z equal to 1 by Z. What do I mean by saying that it is holomorphic at Z equal to 0? Let's skip that a little bit. So these are the most important or the simplest functions. And therefore, I should first learn to play around with these functions, because these are the simplest functions that I want to consider. And by the way, this again is a very natural idea that you must keep at the back of your mind, which is what you're studying a certain context, okay, a certain class of functions or certain context, and you have the simplest examples of that class of functions in front of you. In this particular case, the simplest examples of the class of functions in front of you are translations, inversions, and dilations. So this is something general that you are talking about a class of functions. There are some simplest functions that you have in that class. And therefore, you must first talk about those things that you can generate from that simplest set of functions that you have. So my point is that I have translations, inversions, and dilations, okay? And what is the simplest class of functions that I can generate from translations, inversions, and dilations? How do I generate functions? So if you take two given functions in that class, call them F and G, both are maps from C to C. How will I generate a function from these two? The simplest way of doing that is either take compositions or take additions, multiplications, and things like that. Okay? And you will understand that taking additions and multiplications and inversions of those will give you the same set of things. But what I can do is take compositions. So the question is, what is the class of functions that you can generate from translations, inversions, and dilations? Okay. And generate by what? By taking compositions. Okay. By the way, if I take additions and I take multiplications also, I can do. So I want to take additions, multiplications, inversions, and compositions. This is how I generate. Okay. So the question is, what are the class of functions that I can generate from translations to inversions, dilations using addition, multiplication, compositions, inversions? This class of functions, okay, are called the fractional linear transformations. So the point is, you understand that if you take compositions of any of those, or you take additions of any of those, or you take multiplications of any of those, okay, or you take compositions, you will get a map of this kind. S of Z equal to AZ plus B over CZ plus D for A, B, C, D in C. Okay, please verify this, that if you take the composition, you'll get something like this. If you take the composition or addition or multiplication or whatever of functions like that, you will get a function like this. Again, I'm not worried about what happens when Z is equal to infinity. And we have to, but it's not worthwhile talking about it. If AD minus BC is not equal to 0, then S is called a Mobius transformation. Okay. So Mobius transformations are generated by S1, S2, S3. Okay. And every Mobius transformation is of the form AZ plus B over CZ plus D, where AD minus BC is not equal to zero. Okay. So if I call, you see S is determined by ABCD. So if I call A to be the matrix ABCD, and I call S sub A of Z to be AZ plus B over CZ plus D with AD minus BC not equal to zero. Evaluate. So let A1 be A1, B1, C1, D1, A2 equal to A2, B2, C2, D2. And evaluate SA1 composed with SA2 of Z. Find SA. So SA is a map from C to C. Find SA of find SA inverse of Z. Okay. And then after you do these two calculations, SA1 composed with SA2, I introduce this SL2C. SL2C is all A in GL2C. There should be a closing bracket here. GL2C close bracket, such that determinant of A, 2x2 matrices with entries in C, whose determinant, that means AD minus BC, is equal to 1. And therefore, define phi. Have I defined phi? Let phi from SL2C to the Mobius transformations. I haven't told you what phi is. So phi of a matrix A is S sub A. This SA. S sub A is AZ plus B over CZ plus D, where AD minus BC is non-zero. And now I'm going to restrict myself to AD minus BC equal to 1. And therefore, I'll define S of ABCD. I'll define phi of the matrix A to be S sub A. Please write this down. I have not written that here, unfortunately. I must have been disturbed at the point when I was writing this down. Let phi from SL2C to M, please write this down, take a piece of pen and paper and write this down. Phi of A, capital A, is equal to S sub A. This S sub A. Okay? ABCD is a 2x2 matrix whose determinant is 1, and phi of A is equal to S sub A. M is all Mobius transformation, S sub A of Z is this, and show that phi is an onto homomorphism. We have an onto homomorphism from this group to that group. Therefore, what is its kernel? A group G is simple if and only if the only normal subgroups of G are the trivial groups identity and the whole of G. And the exercise is prove that M, the group of Mobius transformations, is a simple group. Okay. This is actually a very interesting exercise. There's a group set of problems that will lead you to this solution. And this again is one of those exercises that you should do once in your lifetime. And by the way, this is why simple groups first arose, because people were worried about these Mobius transformations. So this was done, of course, before the notion of a group came up. So this group of Mobius transformations is a simple group, and it's an interesting exercise to prove this. The proof is given in a series of problems in Conway. Okay. So you see, there's some very natural way of, there's a very natural way why Mobius transformations arise. And because this is the simplest things that are, this is the simplest thing that arises from, object that arises from compositions of translations, inversions, and dilations. Okay? I mean, there are things like translation of a translation is a translation, is it? Inversion of an inversion is the identity. Dilation of a dilation is a dilation. Translation of an inversion, then translation of dilation, etc., etc. Okay? And the exercise also is to show that, I hope I've written that. So S of Z is AZ plus B over CZ plus D. And notice that when you multiply the matrix A by CD by a scalar lambda, so what I'm saying is S capital A of Z is equal to S sub lambda capital A of Z. If I multiply all the entries A, B, C, D by lambda, I get the same thing. Okay? So there is a C. There is a complex field acting on S, which does not change anything. There's some factorization. No, I shouldn't call it factorization. I should call it, there's some quotient business. There is some quotient business that is going on. You're quotienting out by C. Such a thing is called PSL2R, SL2C. You're quotienting out by the diagonal. It's not P, is only plus minus one, but it doesn't matter. Okay. Anyway, so, you know, now I'm saying that you, what happens at infinity, and then we say that we can define S on C union infinity to C union infinity by the infinity point. Obviously should go to A by C, and the point minus D by C should go to infinity. And then the exercise is that every Mobius transformation is a composition of translations, dilations, and inversion. Okay? This also is a interesting exercise to try and understand. So there, initially, what did I say? I said you take dilations, translations, and inversions. The things that you generate from them, okay, under composition, gives you a Mobius transformation, which is of the form is, so here again I should make a fuss about something. The thing that you generate from translations, dilations, and inversions give you a Mobius transformations. So the set generated by, so I hope you understand that there's something here to be understood. The set of all objects that you get from translations, dilations, and translations, inversions, and dilations under composition. The set that you get from translations, dilations, and inversions under composition, every such thing is a Mobius transformation. Does this imply that the set that you get from, that you generate from compositions of translations, inversions, and dilations, does it imply that the set generated by these things is equal to the set of Mobius transformations? I should make a fuss here. Do you understand what question I'm asking? Let me repeat myself. the set that you generate, everything that you generate from translation, dilation, inversions is a Mobius transformation. Does this mean that the set that you generate from translations, dilations, and inversions is equal to the set of Mobius transformations? Yes or no? Come on, someone should answer this.
I think both.
Yeah? Soham, what? And then Rahul. Yeah, what?
Yeah, shouldn't we consider the case when AD minus BC equals to the non?
No, I want AD minus BC is not equal to zero. Okay.
Yeah, like so, unless then, that is happening, we can't say no.
AD minus BC. Every case you take AD minus BC not equal to zero.
Yeah, but
let me repeat myself. The question I'm asking is the set that is generated by compositions of dilations, inversions, translations. Everything that is generated by compositions of dilations, inversions, translations is a Mobius transformation. Does this imply that the set that is generated by Mobius, by translations, dilations, inversions, is equal to the set of Mobius transformations? What do you think?
Sir.
Someone is answering. Who's answering?
Sir, Roshni.
Roshni, huh?
So to prove that two sets are equal, we show that the first is subset of other and the other is subset of the first.
So
every Mobius transformation can be written in the form of composition of a translation.
So I mean, my first question is that if you just know that this things generated by translation inversion is a Mobius transformation, does that imply that everything generated by Mobius is equal to the set of Mobius transformations? The answer is
certainly I'm not sure about the second inversion. I think it is true and both are true.
No. I'm asking something else. I'm asking that the set of things that are generated by translation is a Mobius transformation. Does this mean that the set generated by inversion is equal to the set of Mobius transformations?
Yes, that's
one. No, sir, that is a subset now.
So do you understand that that just means that what I'm saying is the set A is contained in the set B? The thing that I generated by translations, inversion is a Mobius transformation. So this left-hand side is contained in right-hand side. Okay? So when you do that, all that you're saying is A contained in B. That does not mean that A is equal to B. So you still have to do something to show that A is equal to B. You have to show that you take any element in B, and then that is an element in A. So what I have is, this is contained in that, but to show that these two sets are equal, I should take something that is contained in that and show that it is contained in this. Is this clear to everyone? You know, it turns out that this actually is a place where a lot of people have a mental block. Okay, they will show that A is contained in B, and they will next step say that A is equal to B without doing anything. So the fact that a set A is contained in the set B does not imply that A is equal to B. To show A equal to B, you have to do something. Okay, you have to take an element in the set B and show that it is in the set A. Okay, when I'm stating it in such a stark form, the statement is obvious. But very often people are confused about this. And this again is going to happen, what I'm saying can be disguised in a manner where you do not understand that this is what is going on. So in this context that I have, okay, I know that composition of translations, dilations, and versions is a Mobius transformation. And what you have to show is that every Mobius transformation S of Z is equal to AZ plus B over CZ plus D, is a composition of translations, dilations, and inversions. This is something that you have to prove. So given any S of Z is equal to AZ plus B over CZ plus D, show me how you write S. So you're given A, B, C, D, and S of Z is AZ plus B over CZ plus D. Okay? Show me how you will write S as a composition of translations, dilations, and inversions. Okay? So again, this is something that you have to do. And it turns out that writing it in this way, in a slightly different context, actually again occurs in quite a few occasions. Okay? That the point again is that at this point you must understand that there is something to be done. Okay? And this is what I mean by saying that when you read a book, reading a book is not a passive activity, it is a very active activity. You must actually be asking this question. Prove that every Mobius transformation is a composition of translations, dilations, and inversions. Okay? So, if you have a fixed point of S of Z is AZ plus B over CZ plus D. If you have a fixed point, that means you have a point Z naught. I should not call it Z. I should call it Z naught is a fixed point of S. What is the meaning of a fixed point? A fixed point of S is a point Z naught, such that SZ naught is equal to Z naught. Now, this again is a place where the notation I'm using here is not very nice. I should have called it SZ sub naught is equal to Z sub naught. The reason this notation is not very nice, what I've written, is because Z you think of as a variable, okay? Whereas when you put a Z naught, it is a fixed point. It is not a variable. It is a very specific point, namely the point Z naught. So I should not say SZ equal to Z. I should say SZ naught equal to Z naught. That is a fixed point. Z naught is a fixed point of S if SZ naught is equal to Z naught. Please, take a piece of paper and note down that on this page 16, at the end you should have SZ naught such that SZ naught is equal to Z naught. And then therefore a fixed point will satisfy CZ naught squared plus D minus A Z naught plus B equal to zero. Okay? Z naught is fixed. That means Z naught is a solution to this quadratic equation, CZ squared plus, X squared plus D minus AX plus B equal to zero. And therefore, S has at most two fixed points. Okay? If it has more than two fixed points, that means that it must be the identity map. Okay? So it has two fixed points, and therefore a Mobius transformation is uniquely determined by its action on three distinct points. Because if A, B, and C are three distinct points, such that S of A is T of A, S of B is T of B, S of C is T of C, so S and T take the same values at three distinct points, then T inverse S has three distinct points. T inverse S has three distinct fixed points, namely A, B, and C. And therefore, T inverse S must be the identity. That means S is equal to T. Okay. Actually, I'm nearly out of time. I have 3 minutes remaining. So this is a good place to stop. I will continue from here next time. Okay. So we are going to talk about what happens geometrically for Mobius transformations. Okay. That is what the remaining 4 pages are talking about. So you will see that there are some pictures involved, and you must try to draw these pictures. Okay. This is also a very nice picture. Okay. You try to draw these pictures. What happens to sections? Okay. So I will, what do I want to do? I will stop here, and I will continue from here next time. But of course, if you have any questions, do feel free to ask me. So any questions about what is going on? No? Yes? Katre, we can't hear you.
I can't say anything.
Okay. Okay. So are there any questions? I mean, this looks as if it is, again, what I'm saying is very elementary. On the other hand, I'm trying to make you think in terms of geometry. Okay. And trying to develop geometric intuition is something that people are very reluctant to do. They're happy to do algebra. They're happy to do analysis, but they are very reluctant to think geometry, which I hope you understand is a bit of a, is quite an odd statement, because the intuition that you have, which is most natural, which is best developed, is geometric intuition. You know about geometry much before. You know about geometry when you are in kindergarten. You know about squares and circles and geometry in kindergarten. You don't know about algebra and analysis in kindergarten. Okay. So geometric intuition is there with you. And unfortunately, your education has somehow made you forget or not emphasized your geometric intuition enough. So it is very useful to consciously try and develop whatever geometric intuition in every context that you can have. Okay. Of course, geometric intuition has to be used properly. I'm not saying that it always works. It has to be used in the right manner. But most people do not pay enough attention to what any object means geometrically. So there are no questions, so I keep talking. And now it is 5:45, so I should stop. Any questions? Anyway, still 2 minutes more. Okay, any questions? If you have any questions, send it to me, my email also. Okay, you have my, yes, someone is asking.